there are a lot of bills that relate in some way to social equity. Or it could be pretty narrow, you know, and how did, is there a thought on how we could identify which bills are important for tracking or?
We were talking a little bit about that part of the agenda. And it doesn't have to be so rigid that, you know, we don't, because if we look at all of the different committees that are represented, you know, just in the room at the moment, and the fact that Kaya's comment at the last meeting sparked a bill that we were working on that sparked a reach out from you directly back to the committee, and hopefully, you know, that discussion will start to move that bill to look different and more responsive to the question. You know, but if we hadn't had that discussion at all, you know, even though we're taking testimony.
So can I say, one of my concerns is I listen to how much time we have and what's on the agenda. I would fight, I don't want people to just hear bill numbers and this is where they, I think that would not serve the purpose well, that if we, I want to make sure we get to hearing from people and not just have it be a, like reporting out of these are the bills and they're in this committee and that committee. I mean, there must be a way to do that efficiently so that we get the people have the information and we don't.
So if I can clarify, I think as we were talking about in the last public caucus like that, the concept around the bill tracker actually was more for the external public to have a sense of these are some of the bills that relate to these issues. So similarly to how we had one, you know, I create one for the, you know, for the different kind of BIPOC caucuses that are in the broader state, and for the women's caucus, it was to be able to help people say, oh, I had no idea that there was a bill about accommodations for pregnant women, or whatever, you know, like I had no idea that there was a bill. So you all kind of have a little bit of a pulse on that, and if it comes up as an important crossroads to a dialogue, I'm sure it will be intersected, but I think the thought was just to get that information there, but not necessarily for this to be a sort of, let's go through a checklist of all of the stuff that's either on a wall or is a movement, per se. Do you know what I mean? So from my perspective as a member of the public, it would be helpful for that piece doesn't need to happen here as much as it needs to live somewhere. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that was the thought, and so with that was one of the duties of the intern that would come in, or this supporter would help
to try to identify the
correct.
And help us, you know, by having that repository.
Thanks
for coming.
Of course.
Just what Kaya said, but it would also be very helpful. You know, I've been working on a bill with Kaya, with Coach, to have this as a forum to get further input on where. I mean, this bill is going to change pretty significantly, but that would be really good to get input, and this may be a good forum for that.
So. And that's the hope, you know, of this. Just like Mary Beth, you know, putting a problem before us, you know, that, you know, come to her attention. It might be that it's hanging on the wall in some committee, and sometimes it needs a little inertia to get it off the wall, and this is what this group can actually make happen, you know. So that, you know, that's the action part. But until we hear that, and then we hear from, you know, our friends and neighbors, you know, going, yeah, I was thinking about that crap, dude. You know, and all of a sudden, you know, we start up. Oh, sorry, filter. Okay, so see, as they get older, it gets worse. But
I'm scared when I'm old. Then.
Yeah, I can tell.
Put me and Kaya in a room somewhere.
But I think we have an opportunity, you know, to really that's the ultimate goal.
So for next week's agenda, there's going to be some space for talking about the intern position.
Yeah.
Will that encompass, like, what are our expectations and what does the orientation training look like? Or
We had the notes from that initial discussion, and what we can do is put those last two, and actually with the just the re-announcing of next meeting, we'd have three sets of minutes, basically,
okay.
You know, that would go out, and hopefully that'll help clarify, you know, some of the discussion, you know, around, you know, the intern. And there was a thing in our mailboxes, and I know we've got it upstairs, and it was from UVM about their intern program. You know, that was
exactly.
Yeah. So we'll try to follow up with them. Yes.
I think, yeah, maybe we should talk about the internship, but I think as far as the internship center, it's, I would say that we shouldn't rely on that as far as finding an intern, because it's definitely, to my understanding, the idea is that it's people who are not necessarily in Montpelier or don't necessarily have a way to get here, but working to help from UVM with research surrounding certain legislation. It's possible there'd be a student for whom it would be a really good fit, but I don't think we should count on it. And I think, to me, I guess the intern piece, it seems to me like if somebody is able to take, if one of the affiliated organizations or somebody is really able and willing to take it on, as far as I'm going to figure out how to make it happen to get you an intern, it would be a really positive thing for the group. But it doesn't, like, if that's not something that comes forward, I'm wondering, it seems like a relatively difficult to implement piece, and I'm wondering if maybe we should, you know, have a contingency plan or not an intern, or maybe other people have more thoughts about how to make the intern piece come to fruition.
I had thought that we had talked about that that it might be a couple of people, and they would be actually your track people that just couldn't all come at the same time. And maybe I misunderstood that when we were. So it sounds like there were two different understandings of that.
No. That's why I was going to send out the minutes from that initial discussion, because part of the initial discussion was, we're really not sure what that's going to look like, but we did talk about what might happen, mm-hmm. You know, as far as it could be two people, but having a budget, you know, and working on, you know, funding, you know, that budget, because, you know, like Kaya said, you know, like at that meeting, you know, it's not cool to just expect that, you know, because they're getting credit or not getting credit, and they're doing it for the experience or whatever, that we should, you know.
I guess just to say, I think
I was going to say, I think your idea of, like, an organ, like in the Women's Caucus, we do exactly what you just described. We have somebody from the Commission on Women, like an intern there, take notes, and then someone from the network, they kind of switch off and they take notes and get them back to us, and it works out really well, and then we send them out to everyone. And there's, you know, so there's a little bit of accountability around, you know, and it's not a one person, it kind of goes back and forth.
What do they think? Sometimes my experience is that sometimes it's helpful to have somebody put a proposal in front of a group rather than have a whole group. I mean, I would hate to have bring everybody together and spend even have, you know, a significant chunk of that hour with all the opportunity to hear from each other to spend it talking about how to have an intern.
Exactly.
I mean, that for me would not be a satisfying outcome of getting this caucus
together.
So I don't know. I'm not going to volunteer, and I'm not volunteering anybody else. But I'm thinking, is there some way to kind of, are there people based on what other caucuses are doing or what's been said, maybe bring a proposal forward that might kind of be able to more quickly come to a decision rather than...
Are you making a motion to form an internship subcommittee?
I wasn't.
A working group? A task force?
I wasn't, because we also
a study
decided...
A study committee.
Summer study.
You
using Robert's Rules of Order.
Oh, we are?
I wouldn't have made that motion. But, but I'm just throwing it out there as maybe a way to proceed more efficiently for this group to get to the meat of what we really, at least what I would like to have, which is interacting with each other and thinking with each other.
So let's form a subcommittee.
There's an idea.
Let's piggyback on what Bill said just for a minute, because I'm a little bit out of the loop. I'm sorry I wasn't here last time. I was in Iowa, and the first time in August we had, it was the 24th of August, we had something else going on. Yeah.
Did you pick a candidate while you were there?
Don't mess around in Iowa. You better pick
one. He's a caucus. No,
I just wanted to just briefly just give an idea. Has there been a formation of the other constructs of what we're doing here? I mean, is there a mission statement? Is there a... There's not. Okay. So, because I'm just trying to get my head around my thought as an activist, as a community activist, and also as a coordinator of the Alliance, is I envisioned once the legislators figured out what they were doing, then what we would do is we would come in and present to you and tell you, you know, about some of the issues and tell you about some of the policies that we put forward, and we'd update you on some of the statuses, because clearly just because you're legislators don't mean you understand where they all are. And we'd get some feedback and we'd collaborate and talk about how we can move forward. So does that fit within the framework with what has already been discussed? And this is the main point, is would it be more appropriate to have a broader discussion on, or a committee rather, that would have a broader responsibility on defining the vision and mission of what this group is doing, so we can create a proper framework as opposed to just talking about an intern. Everybody's looking at me all crazy.
I'm hearing you. What I'm hearing right now, though, is that we need to do a little bit more organizational work soon. Mm-hmm. And so what I'm wondering, based on what I'm hearing, is maybe we have a few working groups that in the next week, like a group meets about the mission, a group meets about the interns, maybe another group looks at bills, and we come back, and it's like proposal.
If I may finish, though, I just wanted to stress very strongly, though, that the long-term vision should not overshadow very tactical short-term initiatives that we want to get done, because then it'll just be analysis paralysis, and we won't get anything done.
Yeah. But if you don't have a long-term vision, you don't know what steps you need to work.
And
you know,
that's the rest.
And I'm not volunteering for anything.
Yeah. You'll just tell us everything we did is wrong.
So, I guess talk about filters. You know? Brian, we're gonna have to get one.
Oh, he's good.
So, I think some of this is actually. I think it will be helpful if we can get all of the information that we've had over the last three meetings and just share it with everyone. Your idea about possibly having a couple of people each look at a couple of those topics would be helpful for us all as well. And as far as the, because that'll answer Bill's question about not, let's say using a lot of the group's time, doing that, that part of the work. So
we've got Lucy, who's going to be willing, right, to help write a proposal on the internship.
No. And I say no just because I really don't have any vision on this. This is why I brought it up, because I'm struggling to have vision on it. Yeah. For me right now, to be perfectly honest, if I were to have to do that, it sounds like less work to be the intern myself than to organize getting an intern, which I think is a reasonable thing to have. So this is why I'm not volunteering. If somebody, I don't know if the right person to have vision is a legislator, or the right person to have vision is somebody from an advocacy organization that wants to step up. But yeah, if it was on me, I would just do the intern work, because it sounds less exhausting than figuring out how to work.
I applied for two interns. I basically said, I didn't apply for two. I just said, I'll take interns. And they sent me two people to interview, and they said you can have more than one. And I was going to interview these two interns, just see what they were interested in. And I have like 60 plus bills, so it's just going to be like, you fund all these, you do this, but like, I'd be happy to, if I could find one through that process, to have them be our social equity intern, and I can take on some of the work of helping them as a, like a mentor, but like, they can take on, I'm just saying, I already applied, so and I emailed them and I said, can we meet, and I haven't heard back yet in 2 days, which is not promising, but I'm just saying, like, that I'd be willing to help on some kind of internship effort with others. I'd be willing to help on any of the working groups, wherever I'm needed.
So in order to delegate and move things along, because one of our partners, being the Mark's group, is coming up in about 5-10 minutes anyways. So if Lucy, if you wouldn't mind working with Brian, you know, I know.
She just said she'd rather be the intern than work on this group.
Minutes together to be able to support everybody else who's on this list to understand what's up. Would you be willing to coalesce those? I think it would be better to have a high-level summary and maybe each meeting that might get a little confusing. Just to coalesce, this is where we're at. So then you can put out the call for somebody to help support Brian, because there may be people not in the room who would be happy to do that.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
And do you, in minutes from today, minutes from the last 3 meetings.
Yeah, if possible. Yeah, right. Just recognizing that the goal is to get somebody else to do it.
Right. That's the goal, the long term goal.
And should there be another group that's visioning the mission and whatever?
If there's folks ready to step up.
Yeah. I mean, I'm happy to be part of that. I can only be in Montpelier on Tuesday before, Tuesday and Thursday next week.
Well, I think some of that can be done, you know, remotely. Just because when you look at that 30,000 foot view of notes that we'll have, hopefully that will help bring some of that together. And I'll try to see if I can get the notes from the first meeting that we had. So that we have those as well. Hopefully it gives us some.
I definitely don't want to vision our mission by myself.
Because that would be weird. So I know I'm sure you already know my mission.
Yeah.
But there was a sense, I mean, there's been a sense of the mission, I think it feels to me like the mission is kind of hanging in the air from discussions that have taken place that from the meeting at White River, from the meeting that we last had with everyone in the room. I don't feel like it's like a new, going to be a shock, but I think it should kind of try to bring into one paragraph or so.
No, you already explained it to me, that's why I'm here.
Well, but I think...
There you go.
So...
It's just, yeah, putting it...
Could somebody maybe review, I don't mean to like give work to someone, I'd be happy to do it, but could someone review the notes and create a draft mission from them?
I'm happy to do that.
Okay, all right.
Perfect. Yeah.
And I'll work with you, right?
Okay, great. Perfect. That seems better.
Okay. Cool. Yes. So I think we have our charges together. I'll reach out to the Community Foundation and the Ben and Jerry's as well, since, you know, we have a relationship kind of established already. And if anybody here has any thoughts about an organization that might consider supporting, you know, this kind of an effort. Right now, so Curtis, the partnership is 200, Stefan is 200. I'll give Tabitha a call and guilt her into joining, you know, those three.
Also, the
Root
Social Justice Center might need someone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just
want
to say that I have a long nonprofit history in fundraising and communication, so also a good connection with the Community Foundation folks. I know them all, so if there's any way I can be helpful there, I'm happy to.
So I'll talk.
Great.
Great.
So
whether or not to invite the Agency of Education next week, or whether to wait. I think it was Tom said to hold off on that.
Yeah,
if I can, what I would like to do is actually go back to the coalition and see. I mean, it might be more helpful for us to start with a letter requesting further clarification on it, just so you'll have something to start with.
Right.
But actually, other questions. So the next full community meeting we're saying is next week?
Yeah, Thursday, the 30th.
So the plan is weekly.
Yeah, but the themes will be flexible in the sense that I would hope that vision, whatever you want to call it, if we could get to a rotational piece where we'd reach out and make sure that as many of our colleagues in the House and the Senate can be here at least, you know, one or two of those. And so we do try to work out, you know, with Mark that on those off, you know, weeks would be, we'd still have this joint gathering, but it would be more from an educational perspective because, you know, they've been doing some good work and it'd be great for other people to, you know, just kind of hang out and check that out.
So, what we had said last week was that, which we could change, what we had said last week was that we would meet every other week with like every alternating meeting between legislators and the bigger community,
right.
So that the bigger community would be once a month and legislators would be every 2 weeks. And we can change that, but that's what we had said last week, just to refresh.
So,
you can figure that out.
Yeah.
I would add, I'm sorry, is this a good time for me to talk about this? So the legislative series, is some of you probably heard about it. We started with Hidden in Plain Sight, The Truth About Systemic Racism. And tonight we have Making the Justice System Work with Data. So this is a forum about the history of race data collection in the state, as well as the state of the implementation and the pending legislation that's currently on the wall. Just to let you know, we're also doing a statewide tour, a community tour, and we'll be in your community. We were in Barry last evening. In fact, it got so good that one of the folks that was there came with me tonight. So this is my friend Jason sitting back here. He's came for the next session this evening. And also, we'll be in St. Albans on the 29th and Hartford on the 5th of February. And the 4th of March, we'll be home in Burlington because of, you know, what's going on the 4th of March. That would be the town meeting day area. Bennington, we'll be down in Bennington on the 18th of March and the 2nd of April in Rutland and the 15th of April in St. Johnsbury and the 20th of April in Middlebury. I know many of you are thinking it would have been nice to have had some coordination out front, and I do apologize in advance, but we were really trying to rush and get stuff on the calendar. So we will be reaching out to you, and please reach out to me to try to, you know, create some coordination for some synergy on the ground in terms of collaborative efforts to get something off. So tonight you are welcome to stay around after we close here if you're interested in data.
Are you recording it?
Yes.
It'll be
available.
Yes.
No. Yeah, we would be recording. I'm just giving you a hard time.
Well, no, I just can't stay. Right.
I
have
no
idea. I would
love
to hear it.
Yes.
So
before you all go, I just want you to hear from me that I have a personal issue with the word ally. I don't have an issue with you all using the word ally. We can talk about it more later.
Can you please say that one more time? Because there's a lot of things happening in the language.
Yeah, we had a conversation about language earlier, and one of the words I brought up was the word ally, how it's applied by people who might be allies. So I have a personal issue with those who might apply the word ally to themselves. I don't have an issue with the word ally. It's hard to explain. I just wanted to make sure that we all knew I didn't have.
So can I say it?
Yeah. What's that?
Can I say that word?
Yeah.
That's yes.
That's what
yes,
I'm
saying. Yes, yes.
Why would you use it? We're, okay, good.
So can we get a can we get information on the series?
The series, the legislative series is on the, it's on the legislative calendar.
Okay, and can you just describe
the workshop? So each of the forums, they all map back to some of the policy that the Racial Justice Alliance has been working on, from PR2, which you just passed, thank you very much, 145-0. To H-478, which is the reparations bill, to S-119 and H-464, which is the use of force bill, to H-284, which is the race data collection bill that encompasses the remainder of the justice system. So what we've done is we put together a series of forums that present the facts and the details in a lot of the perspective that we were able to gain from community as we've presented these forums over the last 4 or 5 months up in the Chittenden County area. So we're just bringing them to the legislature to just basically inform some of the decision-making processes that are happening here. And hopefully, you know, we're hoping that the broader community comes in and participates as well. So we haven't been making a lot of progress there, but we're certainly trying to begin to push that effort. Hopefully in the next session or two, we'll have more participation. Is that up? I think we've come, we're probably, we can say we finished the third of three components of, we've gotten this thing passed through the first biennium through both chambers, which I think is laudable. We've got some work to do, some lifting on H-478. We'll continue to speak to the Alliance about, members of the Alliance about our strategy there. We've got a good one. We've already got Coach Skeeman with us as well. So I think we'll get, it'll be entertaining, right? No matter what happens, it'll be entertaining, right? I want to welcome Jason, who is here from Denmark. He was just hanging out with us in Barry last night on our statewide series, which is the hidden plain sight of systemic racism, which is pretty good. We'll be in other communities, as I just indicated previously. I want to just speak a little bit about H-284, which is a justice system data collection bill, which we're really glad that our alliance partners at ACLU brought to the table last year. So that kind of really is what we're going to be drilling down into, not so much the bill itself. We'll talk a little bit about the bill, but mostly I just talk about concept in terms of data collection. I'm proud to say that I sat down with Sarah George earlier this week. We had some very specific conversations about the state's attorney's responsibility, would-be responsibility in the data collection here, and I'm proud to say that she is extraordinarily supportive of this bill, and we've already begun the process of mapping out strategies whereby we would begin collecting data in the larger state's attorney's office in the state. So we're super excited about that. We'll be circling around and having those conversations. We've yet to begin to reach out to folks like Brian Grierson, or folks like folks like who's the new corrections? Something
Baker.
Who?
Jim Baker.
Baker. So certainly we'll want to, I think, strategically, Coach, it'll probably be better for us to maybe pop into the racial disparities in the criminal and juvenile justice system advisory panel, have a sit down with the whole team, and I'm proud to say also that we do know that the panel did produce a report. They just dropped that report about a month and a half ago, and it did include some data collection points that are that intersect with some of the stuff that we're doing. So two other things that I'll make you aware of, at least for now, and we'll talk a little bit about this stuff, is that there is a use of force bill. The appropriate use of force, de-escalation, and cross-cultural awareness, the policy and training, as well as integrating a component of race data collection that is associated with the you know, what, well, if and what use of force was used. That is H-464 is currently under testimony today. Testimony began on that today. I do believe Susanna Davis came out and offered some testimony on that today, as well as I think we'll be taking up testimony tomorrow. They are looking right now for folks who are mostly impacted by force, you know, obviously folks who are directly impacted by use of force with law enforcement, as well as those, you know, concentric circles that go around, you know, supporting communities and those folks. Obviously, well, maybe not so much obvious, not so obviously, but it's a challenge. You know, it's a challenge. You know, if you've been impacted, if you've been traumatized, there's not, you know, you're not going to see a line of folks out the door around the corner, folks lined up to come and talk about it. So we realize that, you know, admittedly, are not equipped to provide that wraparound support that is really required for folks who would need that kind of encouragement and support and protection, frankly, because these are very serious issues that we're talking about. And you know, so I think one of the things that we've learned in this is because we're carrying such a heavy load with the Alliance agenda is that this kind of precludes us from really being able to do the job that we really would like to be doing in those areas, but still we're encouraged because there's still a story to take back to the legislature that basically indicates, you know, as the conversation I had with Borianne yesterday, is that, look, you know, there's another testimony to this, and that is the testimony of the thousands of lives that were impacted that you will never hear from because they've also been silenced. So, again, we're proud to have Falco here from ACLU as well. I think the last piece there, I think we talked a little bit about 464. Well, not the last piece, but S-119 is a mirror bill. It's over in the Senate. It's the same bill. And I hear rumors, despite the fact that it has been taken up in House Government Operations, that our Senator Sears is considering taking up 1S-19 at the same time. That covers data collection, that covers use of force, PR2, that covers reparation. The last bill is more of a bill that is a systemic racism, or anti-racism bill. We'll talk more about that one, but it is a short bill, and so it's not a whole lot to talk about right now, because you know how short bills go. It could be everything, it could be nothing. So I'm just gonna leave that. There's a couple of points of interest that we've had across the legislative session. Has been S-54. We are keenly interested in S-54. We want to, you know, believe strongly, feel strongly that despite the efforts made on S-54 to date, we're still very concerned about the bill. We're very concerned about some of the language that's in the bill, some of the language that's not in the bill. I think there's some serious racial equity and reparative shortfalls in the bill. We're talking about taxation and regulation of cannabis now, just for so you know. And we're acknowledging all of the efforts that have been made to delineate minority business-owned businesses and so forth. But the bill is just basically failing to aggressively take the matter of equity head-on and providing a robust framework to offset those of disadvantaged categories. So we're taking a close look at that. The bill in Illinois, very, very powerful. It's been on the street now for just a little bit over 3 weeks, and it's already changed the trajectory of the lives of literally thousands of people in the state of Illinois. There are 12.1 million people in Illinois, and they still were somehow able to figure out how to create an automatic expungement, language within this particular bill for low-level crime. So I'll leave that there, but I just wanted to, again, I wanted to welcome you to this whole idea of this data collection, or I'm sorry, this, where are we, use of force? Oh my goodness, do I have the wrong recognition? We'll talk through it anyway. We'll talk a little bit about, let me see, what do I have here? What do I have, use of force? I might have the wrong presentation. Bear with me for a minute. Let me just see what I can find. I'll keep talking to you as I look. So instead of digging for that presentation right now, what I'm going to do is, Pat, I'm going to ask you to come up. And because what I was going to do is I was going to do that presentation on the front end and then allow Pat to go on the back end. You know what I'll do is instead of death by PowerPoint, what I will do is I'm going to talk you through some of the dynamics to data collection. I'm going to give you a little bit. When you come up, before you show the dashboard, maybe take them to the Crime Research Group's website and show them what the current state of the data are, mm-hmm. and that way they can kind of get some kind of framework on. Fantastic. So Pat's going to go about 45 minutes, and I'm going to talk to you probably for about another 5 minutes. As far as the background, okay, maybe 10. So as far as the background is concerned, one of the things that I learned, and Bill, you were a part of this effort in the Burlington, Chittenden County area, maybe back about 7, 8, 9, 10 years ago when the Uncommon Alliance was around and Susie Wizzlewhite. It's actually an honor to have you in the room right now because I realize that you were definitely in the midst of all of those discussions, well, many of those discussions that happened regarding the Uncommon Alliance. You know, when Chief Shirley was then the chief of police in Burlington, and I think Chief Whipple was in South Burlington at the time, and then there was the UVM chief, and I think the other one was the Winooski chief. And these four chiefs, what they decided to do was they began to take people of color serious about their complaints about being stopped on a regular basis. There was many, many complaints that were being brought to then Attorney General Sorrell's attention, all to no avail. So what we did is we started a grassroots effort in the community. I shouldn't say we because I wasn't there. What they did is they started a grassroots effort in the community, in Chittenden County, and they began to voluntarily collect data, voluntarily, these four agencies that I just named. Very quickly, the state police, which is the largest police force in the state, which comprises 33% of all of our law enforcement agency officers, and they cover 90% of the landmass of the state. They quickly jumped in, so we had four agencies, the largest two agencies in the state and three other Chittenden County agencies, all collecting data. Disclaimer, I am a police commissioner in Burlington. So what happened was that this data became public. Stephanie Seguino, who's a great friend of ours and had a lot to do with this race data, this race traffic stop dashboard that you're going to see in a few minutes, she became involved and began to help correlate the information with a professor named Nancy Brooks. And what was released, you know, eventually was a report, and that began the entire process. It would mature to the point to where there would be legislation. From it came also the Fair and Impartial Policing policy development. And not to say it did not pre-exist, because previously it was residing in the Attorney General's office. The model policy was. There was talk of moving it to the Law Enforcement Advisory Board's office. There was all kind of conversation about what to do about it, but then migrant justice would become involved. So it would take unto itself a life of its own, the Fair and Impartial Policing policy. But here's the deal, just to understand where we are, is that multiple iterations of this data collection policy under the Title 20, 2366 would occur. Our legislature, our judiciary branch in the House and Senate would take multiple stabs at fleshing out what race data collection, what traffic race data collection looks like in terms of Title 20, 2366, as well as Fair and Impartial Policing policy, which is under the same statute, and then Title 20, 2358, which is the implicit bias training. Okay, so that's where all of this kind of grew from, and I just want to keep you mindful of the fact that over all of this, there is an overarching umbrella that we will continue to come back to and beat drums on until the cows come home, is this concept of civilian oversight of law enforcement. Civilian oversight of law enforcement. Because we can do all of this stuff great, but if the police ignore it and they choose not to collect data, if they choose not to do it consistently, if they choose not to turn it in, if they choose not to train their folks, if they, and so on and so forth, then what have we really done? So I just want to kind of keep that framed, because it's a proper framing, because I think it's really the essence of some of the issues that we're challenged with today. So I will say that to date, I think, well, let me just back up. It would be probably 2016 when the state police, after having released 1 year of data and having started in somewhere about 2011, okay, it wouldn't be until 2016 that the state police would actually release 5 years of data. Happened in 2016, I know because I was in Royalton when it happened, so were you. 2016. So they actually sent data down to Northeastern University with Professor Jack McDevitt, and that data was actually kept from us despite the requirements to release it. And it was actually reviewed by the professor, and there were reports that were released, and then finally the data were released. We've had challenges with collection of data since its inception. And I think Pat will speak to just the problematic nature of the condition of race data collection to this very day. Now, Pat, you can just go ahead and come and prepare, because I think I'm done now. But what I'll tell you about after Pat gives his presentation, and we'll be pushing up against right about 7 o'clock. We were originally planning to get out of here by about 7:30, but I think we may be out by 7:15. What we'll do is we'll have a conversation about the proposed legislation that is currently on the table regarding race data collection, as well as we may even cross over and talk a little bit about a proposed policy that Senator Babe Ruth just put forward that is pretty interesting. It talks a little bit about a carrot and a stick, mostly a stick, whereby grant funding could potentially be held back from law enforcement agencies from non-compliance. So I'll tell you a little bit more about all that and more. Pat, thanks for coming. Pat, I can never remember how to say his name properly. I'm going to say Attilio.
Perfect.
Attilio.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for coming. So this presentation, I won't cover things that Mark already introduced, but it comes from a bit of a different angle. I've given this a couple times to a couple of groups around the state, and it continues. It's an evolving deck. But so I'll talk about my kind of viewpoint of why we should be looking at race data with respect to traffic stops and across the country and then within Vermont, and then the challenges we're seeing with the data and why we're not really there yet, even though we're getting a higher rate of reporting from the state agencies. And then we'll dive into the dashboard, which is where I've crunched the data that's been coming in from Vermont's law enforcement agencies and put it up on a website to make it accessible to everybody. And I'll be showing lots of screenshots for that. So it will be, I apologize for death by PowerPoint, but it's where I live. And and then some future things that we have planned for the dashboard, and then a bunch of references at the end. So I will share this slide deck. It's got a ton of links to some of the references that I, and resources that I made.
If you said it before, I'm super sorry, but I don't remember who you work for, or what is your role.
That's good.
Kind of
that's
wondering good. Myself.
Yeah.
So it was just about a year ago that I contacted Mark Hughes and started tuning into the things that he had going on with his Justice for All organization mm-hmm. at the time, and starting at the Racial Justice Alliance. It was something, I moved to Vermont 2 years ago from New Jersey. I was concerned with seeing a lot of racial inequities happening in this state. It surprised the hell out of me. So I wanted to get involved with something there. My background is in IT. I worked in a number of large corporations for my career. I'm basically retired now. but I have degrees in computer science, data analysis, database building, data warehouse, was last 21 years at Hewlett Packard. So I had all the skill set that since I retired 5 years ago, looking for a good place to focus my skills. When I was talking with Mark, the Racial Justice Alliance, I said, gosh, I have no experience or really inclination for haunting the halls of the State House and being on legislators. I would really like to bring my data analysis skills to bear. And gosh, this traffic stop data eventually popped out.
Right.
So I've been working on the dashboards you'll see since March.
Awesome.
Good question. Thank you. All right, that's my hand. Nationwide, the U.S. public has contact with police officer here. About 20% of American citizens have contact with a police officer. And the vast majority of those are through traffic stops and accidents. So it's kind of our vision, our viewpoint as citizens when we have face-to-face contact with an officer that's usually alongside the road. So that's like, you know, if there's disparities in the area of traffic stops, that's going to affect a lot of us. And during the 70s through the 80s and 90s, the nature of traffic stops changed dramatically. And with respect to, in the name of the war on drugs and the war on crime, traffic stops used to happen when some obvious safety or traffic violation was happening or there was an accident, then the police would get involved. During the 70s, 80s, and 90s, that kind of turned around, and traffic stops began to become at least half the time investigatory, looking to see, make sure there aren't drug couriers happening, things like that. So there was a major switch happening during there. And if you the new Jim Crow is a great reference work on this change that has been written about in many other contexts. Okay, so in light of that, starting. And North Carolina gets credit for being the first to really do traffic stop data collection in this country. North Carolina passed legislation in 1999 to do traffic stop data collection. And the initial bill they have collects a much broader set of data than Vermont does to this day. So they're really the benchmark for traffic stop data collection. Although you can see, there's a group called the Stanford Open Policing Project that is gathering and collecting data from all over the country, from state patrols as well as municipal law enforcement agencies, gathering that in one place so we do a nationwide comparison of race data across traffic stops in the country. And you see they've got about half the states involved here, and Vermont's in there, but Vermont only has kind of not even what we have today available to us. They don't have it in Stanford yet. I do want to mention this book. North Carolina was the first to get credit. They have 22 million traffic stops in their database. So of course, it's going to push them 20 years now, and they had never done an analysis of the data. That was just piling up. So this researcher by the name of Frank Baumgartner wrote this book called Suspect Citizens. And if you really want to go deep on traffic stop data and how to collect it right, that is a definitive work. I read it with interest. So North Carolina, they update their site. Their website, I think, is monthly with the latest data. Monthly. Just last week, we got available to us as Vermont citizens, and the legislature got available to us Vermont's 2018 traffic stop data. It just came to us in the last week or two. So North Carolina releases their latest data every month on their website here for everyone to see. California's got a pretty good program, and they got nice graphics. And then I mentioned the Stanford. So this is a good starting place to see what else is going on around the country. In a nutshell. Mark already mentioned that in 2014, legislation did get passed in Vermont to mandate the collection of law enforcement data in the state from all state, local, county, municipal law enforcement agencies were at this point required by September 1st, 2014 to produce traffic stop data, which includes age, gender, and race of the driver, the reason for the stop, if there was a search, why there was a search, was there anything found in the search, and whether there was a warning issued or a ticket or an arrest or nothing at all. So this is all language from that. Is it really an amendment to the section of the law that was passed at this time? So this did not solve all the problems, but it was a great step forward in 2014. Okay. So challenges. All right. So I just mentioned there are long delays. It's not entirely clear why that is, but the current bill reads is being interpreted basically by September of the following year, the law enforcement agencies need to provide the data. So it's a 9-month lag every year. And then I'll show you a flow chart that was handed to this group called the Crime Research Group that massages the data and makes sure it's all compliant, but also minimally compliant, shall I say. They tend to filter out any additional data that the agency provides and just limits the data to the minimal amount. So that creates delays. We do have some agencies in the state that are still providing no data or very hard to use data. A lot of times it'll be lacking the date and time of the stop. So they say, here's our 2018 data, and all we know is it happened sometime in 2018. So there's a lot of interesting analysis we could do with the date of the year and the time of day, and that's not in there for many things. I've kept careful notes as I tell this data as to what's missing from which law enforcement agency. I'm feeding that back to the crime research group, and hopefully they can help us respond to that and improve it. File formats, this is getting better, but I just in the past 2 weeks, I've brought in the, analyzed the 2018 data, now that it's available. And there's 23 different file formats today. So these are every law enforcement agency. Many law enforcement agencies have their own files they deliver. It's usually an Excel file, and there's 23 distinct formats that I have to adapt to.
Do you mean the file type or how they write up the data?
The columns, the orders of columns, what columns they provide, and the values they put in the columns. So if you think of race data as being black, Asian, or Hispanic, it could be, say, black, it could say African, you could say B, you could say BLK. There's like, long mapping tables.
But it kind of sounds like that was our responsibility to create a, what's it called, like a blank, fill out
well,
sheet that they
so come up. If you think as a legislator, the law should have been much more specific in terms of the format that it should be provided, like field by field, value by value. Dr. Seguino, who did the original analysis, has put together a memo with Nancy Brooks to specify much more clearly what we need in the state. Because this is what we're dealing with now. Moving along, some law enforcement agencies have very small amounts of data. It's not their fault, they're not stopping. They're very, very small. They've got like, I don't know, 4 officers or 6 officers or a constable. So they only provide a few rows of data. That's fine, it's just we can't really do an analysis on it because it's not, can't do statistically significant analysis. It wouldn't be valid to call, to point to that agency that is being inequitable. And I already mentioned that often the fields are blank, but they're not coded properly. This is just a chart to show how things are improving. As Mark said, we didn't really get anything until 2016 and then started getting backfill. It's only in 2017 where we got nearly all of the 78 Vermonties. I think that's all but two or something. In 2017, finally, they reported something. Sometimes it was a handwritten sheet with a PDF scan. But and then the 2008 bar is just, was able to fill that in the past few days. So you see the Vermont State Police are pretty consistent. I mean, it goes down, but it's just because they consolidated their barracks. Mm-hmm. So they've been just, the green bars of the Vermont State Police, they're in there. They're reporting it pretty consistently now. It tends to be the sheriff departments that are a little lag behind some of the police. All right, I'm a nerd, so I like flow charts and things and stuff. So, primarily, this is a little frustrating to think about all the file formats I talked about, because all the data is basically stored in these two systems in Vermont. There's one called Spillman, one's called Valcor. Those are the systems the police have on their screens, and they fill them out, and it goes into these central systems and for their own reporting and analysis, presumably. In fact, we're now getting the Spillman data coming through right to us. So there's some 29 agencies or so that are coming through the Spillman angle, which is great. So check that one off. About half the agencies are in one format. This is Valcor one, somehow they all get chewed up when they go to the different agencies and through crime resource groups, so we wind up with a lot of different files there. But they promised the Valcor angle will also, someday we'll just get two files, maybe one to process instead of 23. So again, these central systems run by some vendor, each 78 law enforcement agencies fill those out and send them over to this group that puts them on the website. You can go to this website, it's a public website, and download their Excel files. And again, there's gazillions of them. And then initially, Stephanie Scalino of University of Vermont and Nancy Brooks of Cornell created a database with an intern, a grad student. And they did the initial analysis in 2016. They published a paper called Driving While Black and Brown in Vermont. Created a bit of a splash. They published that in early 2017. It made quite a bit of press, and it showed that there was definitely racial bias going on in traffic stops in Vermont. So that was a database an analysis they'd done in 2016. When I came on in the scene last year, there was 3 years worth of data sitting there waiting to be analyzed and assimilated. So I got the database from Dr. Seguino and started my own. Where I took all of her data, the 600,000 some rows, traffic stops, and I started importing what had happened since from the crime research group. And now I've got 2017, 2018, and this is in a database that I've created. It's a single MySQL database, and I've moved it up to a cloud server now, so it's safe and robust. And as of last week, we now have 882,000 traffic stops recorded in Vermont since 2011. May sound like a lot, but remember, North Carolina has 22 million. So. But this is enough, we can start to do some real statistics on it.
But this is Vermont.
This is Vermont, it's not North Carolina.
Statistically, isn't there a point where like 1,000 more isn't going to change the results?
That's true. I mean, it's really starting to level out.
Yeah.
I do some trend analysis, you can see how it changes year over year, and it does.
Okay.
So year by year. And also, on a statewide basis, the numbers tend to be pretty consistent if you look at the aggregate. But if you compare one law enforcement agency to the next, there's wide disparities. Like you can compare all the traffic stop rates of all the law enforcement agencies in Chittenden County or in any county in the state. It's all over the map how the percentage of stops, or the traffic stops, are people of color. So we'll get to that And so from this database, I wrote a bunch of web code to produce these pretty charts. And thank you for your questions, this helps. All right, yeah, so the dashboard, I already talked a little bit about the history here. The data's been around, it's been sitting in Excel files, it's not useful, really, to do any broad brush analysis. Mark mentioned the professor at Northeastern University, Jack McDevitt, and analyzed all of Vermont State Police, but he didn't go there when it came to taking all those individual law enforcement agencies and trying to aggregate and do a Vermont-wide analysis. It took some like obsessive retired guy like me to do all that work. So the raw data isn't that useful up there on the website. So I talked to Mark Hughes, and he said, gee, could you put up a chart, you know, let every citizen in Vermont pick their local law enforcement agency and view their data there? Sounds like a good idea. Could you summarize it across the years and get trends? And could you, try to make them such that any racial bias or profiling would pop up? Okay, I can do that. So on November of last year, we had a meeting over in Burlington where I rolled out the initial version of this dashboard. And it's out on the VermontRacialJustice.wordpress.com. On the homepage, you just scroll down the homepage, and you can get to this, and you can click on it, and browse it at your leisure. And again, the summary across all years for state police and sheriff department and other police agencies, and then have year-by-year trends for all of those, and then finally have the comparison the comparison within each county of the agencies within the county. So yeah, it's a long word, but vtracialjusticealliance.wordpress.com, Well, if you go to this website, you can get to that chart.
Is the data itself available?
It is not yet. It's not yet. So you want to play with the Excel files or the SQL database?
I want the possibility to.
Yeah, it's on my list.
Okay.
It's on my list. It's unless you're a real data geek, it's not bad.
Yeah, okay.
It's not that satisfying. I'll show you most of these charts. For the sake of time, I'll show everyone. But the data I capture here are on stop rates. Okay, so one like the initial thing you want to ask is, are a person of a particular racial group being stopped more often than how they're reflected in the population? So if 1% of Burlington are black drivers, and they get stopped 2.8% of the time, that's suspect, right? There's something going on there. So that's the first thing we look at. And then there's two ways of looking at that I'll describe. And then there's a percent of stops that are male drivers, because studies have shown that black male drivers are stopped more than white male drivers as a percentage of the drivers. And then once a person is stopped, that's when it gets really interesting, okay? Once a car gets stopped, what percentage of stops are resulting in a search? And what are the disparities there? Yes. If there's a search, is there contraband actually found? No. not nearly to warrant all the searches that are in. So I'll show you those. And then the percentage of stops resulting in arrest, or a ticket or warning. So those are the basic charts you'll see with different slices and dices as we go through here for different law enforcement agencies. Okay. So here's the first one. So you go to that, the top link when you go to that web page and you ask for a summary. This is the summary, and any of those summaries, you can pick County Vermont, it's kind of funny, but you pick Vermont, and then all Vermont agencies. And this is the one that's gotten pretty consistent because we got so much data now. Okay. So We don't have white drivers here, because white drivers would, they would, the bar chart would be off the slide, or these would get very flat. So white is like 99%, 96%, and they're stopping on 93%. But these are the interesting ones. Black drivers in Vermont, there's about one, so about 1.8% of drivers in Vermont are estimated to be black drivers. But they're stopped at 2.7% of traffic stops for black drivers.
Pat, so, can you tell us what qualifies a driver? In this research, how are you getting at who a driver is? What is census as opposed to
how do we determine this number? What percentage of drivers?
Yeah,
that's a problem. Mm-hmm. And this view is a little problematic as a result mm-hmm. of that. So, your first reaction would be, well, let's use census figures, right?
Right.
But studies have shown that even though black residents of community may be 3%, they may drive less. They drive less than 3% of the drivers may be black, or Hispanic groups tend to be driving less than whites as a demographic. So census is not perfect. We use it where we have to. Better, and what we've used in most of this data is Vermont Department of Motor Vehicles traffic accident data, which captures some of the racial makeup of the person, the driver involved in the accident. It's not consistent, but it's closer, because you can kind of understand that if the percentage of people getting in accidents, well, it's probably pretty close to the percentage of drivers. Unless you can imagine why one demographic, one racial group would be worse drivers, be more accidents. I don't know. But that's kind of the benchmark or the standard for determining the blue line. But it's not perfect, right? It's not perfect. And Sebastian did it. Oops, I'm going to back up one. Oh, yes. And before we go any further, so you'll notice the data talks about white, black, Hispanic, and Asian groups. Okay, this is problematic. So we've got to track the race of the driver, but I think we all know race is a cultural fiction, and you can't define it clearly. Right? You try to rigorously define race, you realize it's a fiction. And some ethnicities we know are subject to bias and racism, like Hispanic people. It's not generally considered a race, it's considered an ethnicity. I could mention Arabic peoples and other ethnicities, okay? So, but an officer's perception of a driver's race or ethnicity is what matters when it comes to considering whether they're going to act in a biased way. So what counts here is what the officer puts in a little checkbox. So we kind of luck out there. Right? An officers today in Vermont or anywhere else don't ask the driver what race you consider yourself to be. They just check the box. As their own, it could be, who the heck knows how they figure that out. But that's the data we have, and we have pretty good confidence it would correlate with any sort of bias that's going on. All right. So the traffic stop data we get, it has six race categories: white, black, Asian, Hispanic, Native American, and unknown. Okay. You won't see Native American in this data, because there's consistently across everywhere not enough data to even report. It's a category that police have put there, but they rarely check off that for whatever reason. They just don't want to go there. We don't have enough data to report on Native Americans, so we don't. Unknown kind of makes it's not helpful, so we don't report on that. So you wind up with a fork. white, black, Asian, Hispanic. It's what we have.
Is it useful to say anything about, I mean, I've lived through this because I helped write these laws.
Yeah, there you go.
So, I mean, I don't know if it's helpful to comment at all on why the design is as it is, because, I mean, this was a decision that we did not want police officers asking people at roadside, well, what race are you? Mm-hmm. I mean, that was actually coming out of the...
It creates your own problems.
Yeah, it creates a whole other set of
problems. I know people would say green.
Well, I mean, I'm just trying to explain, right? Yeah. I mean, and it came out of initially the voluntary, the police agencies that said they were going to collect this data on a voluntary basis, Burlington, South Burlington, UVM, Winooski, initially,
mm-hmm.
and working with a consultant to talk about how can we create data that we, because we want data to go along with all the stories that mm-hmm. we heard, and that, so a lot of this was built on their experience in those agencies, and then the state police began to do it, and it was just determined that you did not want officers asking that question at
right,
roadside,
yeah.
but it has inherent flaws, and
yeah,
one of the things I asked numbers of years now, boy, I would love to have somebody do a study, if there's a way to do a study of going back and comparing what the officer perception is with what the self-identification
yeah.
would be
yeah.
by those who had been stopped.
Mm.
I mean, how yeah. consistent or inconsistent is that? And
right.
it was,
right.
it'd be interesting to know.
It's never been done, and there were reasons. I mean, I'm trying to remember all the reasons why it wasn't done, but...
It's pragmatic.
Yeah, and you again, it raises questions of trying to engage people in a conversation they might not want to be part of.
Yeah.
But that's part of what led to it being officer perception.
Yeah.
As opposed to anything else, because that's what.
And we could, it could be, you know, it's a start. It seems to
work. I'd be curious, is that what happens in other jurisdictions?
Yeah, as I recall, that's what.
Okay. Yeah, I think this was basically built on what other, how data was being collected elsewhere.
Yeah.
I think it's also really important to remember how this all started, because again, Bill was there, and this was specifically, you know, a community of color in Burlington, and frankly, it had much to do with, about black people, you know, quite frankly, and you know, I may have not been there, but I know it was Act 134 in 2012, mm-hmm. Representative Wizawadi was where this entire thing kind of mushroomed,
mm-hmm.
and I think that from records that I was able to see, there's a lot of conversation about this whole idea of discriminatory practices against specifically people of color, black people specifically, and there was also some I'll share some more with you in a little bit, but some talk of the remainder of the justice system, and we'll talk more about that later, but somehow or another we kind of started to just focus on police. But there, as we started to talk about police, it was really important that not only do we not have a requirement of folks to, you know, or this conversation about what color are you, but also we didn't want it on licenses either at
mm-hmm.
that point. And I don't think that's
yeah.
ever changed. I don't think it's on licenses either.
Yeah, it brings its own problem.
Yeah.
An interesting aside, in North Carolina, when they decided, when they're talking about passing this legislation, there were actually two groups that came into alignment, the people concerned with racial disparities
mm-hmm.
and the people who were defending the police. They said, we're gonna collect this data and we're gonna do it right so that we can show definitively once and for all there's no bias,
mm-hmm.
there's no disparities. So there was a whole other cohort in the legislature in the county that's pushing for this.
Mm-hmm.
That's
and
the beauty of data.
They were surprised
that
they turned out these people. So moving along after that little aside, this is just to point out hover over there with your mouse or click on it on your phone, and it'll give you the numbers, okay? So you can see where that percentage came from. In this case, across all Vermont, across this time period, 2010-2018, we have 819,000 stops recorded, and then 22,288 of those stops involved black drivers. So that's just to show you those tooltips are there. This is just, this bottom view is called the Racial Disparity Index. Sounds like a big name, big word, scary word, but it's just to show, it divides this number by this number, this number by this number, the stops divided by the population, to show that the whites, they're 99% of the drivers, they're 99% of the, so it's 100, I'm sorry, it's pretty easy, right? They get stopped as much as the driver percentage. But the blacks, if you divide 2.2 into 1.7, you see it's 115. I'm sorry, I'm talking too fast. 2.7 divided by 1.8 is 151%. So that just shows you there's a disparity there. And it's pretty big for blacks. Asians, yes, are consistently stopped at a lower rate than even whites. Science doesn't align. And Hispanics are stopped typically more than even blacks as a percentage of the driver population. Okay. So to kind of come down off of the Vermont summary, I'm from Windsor County, so I picked the Royal Tin Barracks of the Vermont State Police, and you see that, some law enforcement agencies have more dramatic results than others. So for Royal Tin, the disparity index for blacks is 3 times. They're stopped 3 times compared to the driver percentage. And Hispanics almost 4 times. Yeah, that's in for what the parts of, you know, typically the highways, Route 89, 91, that are covered by Royal Tin. And these are the numbers behind it. I just threw those on. All right, so moving along to some of the other data, we talked about searches. So if you are stopped, what is the percentage of time that your vehicle is searched? Okay, by race. So you can see here, this is another disparity that pops out at you. Blacks are searched at a rate, you know, nearly 4 times what whites are. Hispanics are high, Asians are low. So those officers, presumably their working theory is that they're more likely to find something. Or, you know, think of your reason why they'd be stopping people of color at a higher, to search their car, and to search their car at a higher rate. And then where it gets really interesting is to say, okay. Oh, there's a tooltip. I got the 3.4%. Where it gets really interesting is, okay, so are they finding things in the car that result in arrest? Are they, as a result of their search, are they finding things that are worthy of arrest? No. They're actually, what we call the hit rate for the finding contraband, it actually turns out to be low. So this shows by no means are officers justified in a higher search rate of people of color, because they're not finding it in the early rate. So this is across all Vermont, you're seeing here. And your mileage may vary depending on what law enforcement agency you're looking at, but some of them are pretty dramatic. And you have to think about blacks and Hispanics, so this 10% roughly, that means 9 out of 10 people who are stopped and have a car search have nothing. And what's the impact? What's the impact of that? How do they feel about the police when they're stopped and searched, and stopped and searched, and stopped and searched? Okay. Arrests and tickets. a similar story. This is across all Vermont. Blacks are arrested at a higher rate. Hispanics are arrested at a higher rate than whites once they're stopped. Tickets are kind of across the map. They're kind of not a significant difference between. And I didn't even put warnings in there. Warnings tend to be pretty much consistent. Although some studies have shown get more warnings and tickets for minority groups, also because it justified, you know, gives them some justification that they did the stop in the first place. All right, so getting toward the end here, these are the trends. This is an interesting one for the Vermont. So you can go see VSPL, it's all Vermont State Police. We're looking at these two charts. This is, again, the search rate and the hit rate with arrests, okay? So the search rate is interesting here. So the search rate, so the white search rate, the red bar of the white search rate is very flat over time. And the black search rate was going up and up and up until they, I could say until the reporting of the data started coming.
Mm-hmm.
I can say that. Mm-hmm. But in any case, it's been going down. It's very interesting. And it's kind of hard to read, but the finding things is still pretty consistently lower, although it does tend to jump around. And these tend to be pretty small numbers, which is why it jumps around. We don't have hundreds of thousands of these numbers, so they do tend to be a little more variable from year to year. Tough to draw conclusions there. All right, and I did mention you can compare law enforcement agencies within your favorite county. Again, I live in Windsor County, and this is that disparity index. So someone like Royalton stops blacks, you can pick your county and then pick your race, and it'll pop the chart up for you. So this is blacks in Windsor County, black drivers. So Royalton, we talked about being three times, stop three times the rate, how much they drive. You can see some are worse and some are better, and all of them are over 100%. But so that's another set of charts. That's the seventh one on the page.
But I can find Windham County on there and see a similar thing.
Windham, yeah.
Yeah.
I can do that. okay. And you get this is a similar chart for arrests. Here the data is small, and this is just to show that some data is small for some of these. So sometimes you'll see no percentage at all, and there'll be a note saying, if there's fewer than 20 stops, we won't show the data at all. So sometimes it's 0%, but if it's zero, if it doesn't show anything, that means there's not enough data to show. It's not statistically significant. It would be unfair to show it.
So thank you for your work. Frustration, you know, just as a person of color, let alone as a legislator, is this really brings to heart that age-old comment, garbage in, garbage out. And it's really hard to disaggregate data that is not consistent. And, you know, I was happy to hear that you were part of that memo coming from the Savannah Brooks Consortium, because the information speaks for itself, what we do have, but in order to really get to the meat and the heart of the question, we need to have those fields be consistent, and that data input.
I know very well what you're talking about. I could expand on even what we proposed, what Dr. Savino proposed, based on what I've learned from North Carolina. There's a lot more rigor we could put around this that wouldn't be onerous to the police. But, we don't want to make a traffic stop like applying for a mortgage. We're going to sit there for a you got to make it doable. But there's things we could do.
Yeah.
But you're right about quality of data. It's got a ways to go.
So I just have a quick question. Internet data and just thinking about the other forms of data that are considered in H.284 and some of the comments we're hearing about different file formats and other things like that, just as a practical consideration. I'm interested to hear some of the legislators' thoughts on this. I feel like mandating in statute the specific file formats and stuff is way too granular.
You don't want to.
But in terms of mechanisms, that be something that you think about doing through rulemaking, or so as we think about mandating this data and want to make sure it's uniform, but also not being overly prescriptive in statute, which is really hard to change or adjust to. I'm just throwing that out there as something that I think that as we're having these conversations, we're thinking about as a practical matter.
Falco, could you repeat the last part of what you just said? You said over-prescriptive, is that what you said?
Yes, okay. Yeah.
That's
so, well, I think you can speak this when sometimes in statute, there might be really good intentions, but they're also for a very good reason as you're starting to see how this is implemented practically, there might be a need to make a small tweak to how something is being implemented or something like that, and then there might be a need to go through the entire legislative process again, which is overly cumbersome and wouldn't allow for some of those changes to be made in a more, practical manner without having to go through that all again. So I think that's just something I'd be interested in trying to think about what the best way is.
Could be made as a matter of regulation. I don't know how Vermont works.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that would more likely be rule, but then that also requires rulemaking.
But it may not even necessarily, I don't know, it's helpful to jump in here, but I'm 5 years out of this. I mean, I chaired the Judiciary Committee when we did this. I sponsored the legislation.
I didn't know you were chair.
Yes, for 10 years.
Nice.
Yeah, that's why this happened.
I must have missed that one.
I don't mind saying this. That's why this happened.
Right.
Because in fact, I'm thrilled with what you're doing, because I can tell you, it's been, if it weren't for Stephanie Seguino, we wouldn't have had any of the analysis. Well, we had the initial analysis that the state police, we had to appropriate money to get the state police to do an analysis. And I'll just point out one thing that's just that happened along the way. The initial state police analysis, when we looked at it, we went, no, this is not going to work. Because when you looked at the way it's higher risk, higher stops for blacks, lower for Asian, higher for Hispanic, and compared to whites,
they combined
everything together into one category. And we go like, no, you know what the implication of that is, or the consequence of that is that in fact you don't get to see the higher disparities for black men, for Hispanic men, or for Hispanics. And so it took another whole push to try to get the state police analysis to disaggregate that. And basically we had to basically say, if you don't do that, if you don't agree to do that, you will not be getting your funding to do this, because we're not interested in having bogus analysis once we've finally tried to get data and then have a bogus analysis.
Yeah.
So it's like one piece after the other had to be pushed and pushed and pushed. I kind of lost my train of thought. Was I starting to? Oh, in terms of how to achieve it, you do not. I mean, again, to try to put a form at one point, to try to put a form in statute is just a mistake, because just for what you said, because you may want to change that to get through the whole, everybody knows the whole process of getting a bill through this place is a big deal. But what I'm remembering that we tried to do, and I don't know if this, what I'm remembering was trying to get the Criminal Justice Training Council, or an entity that had some influence or could actually had levers over all of the law enforcement in the state, for them to try to impose or facilitate whatever you want to do, but some level of require law enforcement to have more consistent data, and frankly, it took a long time to get the reporting of data from the sheriff's departments, from the local police departments. The state police and the five were always, the leaders in this, but to try to put something granular in statute is, it seems attractive at a certain level, but it's not, and even regulation. But I'd have to, I mean, I'm not in that world the way I was 5 years ago, but trying to find some middle ground of trying how to get the requirement in there. And of course, we're Vermont, where nobody wants anybody at the central point of anything to tell people what to do, whether it's schools or police or hospitals or anything else. So God help us when we're trying to get something done consistently across databases. It's a big challenge. I came to sit on this because I was much wanting to hear what the proposals are currently. So I said, I had to step back because I got asked to take on other responsibilities. But statutory granularity on this is not.
That's something that is actually being currently
okay,
proposed.
Okay. Well, okay.
Should I talk a little bit? I don't want to interrupt.
Yeah, I just want to point out that. There's the books I was talking about, and the data, and raw data, and some aggregated data nationwide.
So before we go to the bill, first I want to acknowledge and thank Pat for his work, and also want to, we've got another one, his name is Jeremy, and we've been trying to, rope in other folks who are interested in data into the Alliance as well. So the Alliance is working really hard, and this is just one of the areas where we're working. But it's in direct alignment with all of the work that we're doing, because it does converge. If you think about, this is really, if you walk this back to, its origination, this is right out of Act 54. Okay? This is right to the heart of Title 20, 2366 and 2358. And it speaks consistently to all of the work that we've been doing, to include Act 9, the Racial Equity Director. I think that one of the things that I appreciate about the work that we're doing is even the United Nations, this report that I'm holding from the General Assembly, the Human Rights Council, it made it pretty clear. They said the working group urges member states to adopt a human rights-based approach to data by providing a disaggregation, self-identification, transparency, privacy, participation, and accountability in collecting and storing data. So this is from the United Nations. They also said that the working group urges states to collect, compile, analyze, disseminate, publish reliable statistical data at a national and local levels, and to take all other related measures which is necessary to assess regularly the situation of individuals and groups of individuals who are victims of racism, racial discrimination, xenophobia, and related intolerance. So, the work that we're really doing, sometimes the necessity is obfuscated because of who we are as the racist nation that we are. In a lot of ways, our federal policy is not reflective of global standards like the United Nations, which we walked out of last year. One of the kind of tenets that we've been operating off of us is the accurate and complete, the fact that accurate and complete and consistent data are required for a fair government for all of us. So that's really what this is all about. If you recall, Bill, back in with the Uncommon Alliance, the whole genesis of what we're talking about was black people being discriminated against by law enforcement. That's where we started. What we found in the course of our work with Act 9, I think I'm going to plug in there too.
Okay.
Act 9, when we finally decided, well, before Act 9, what we figured out with Act 54 was, thanks to the hard work of many of our I'm going to plug this one here.
What's your name?
This one here?
Yeah. Hi.
Wayne Brenda Pop. Siegel.
Oh, Brenda, I was trying to pop up the
I think you need to slide that whole, yeah.
Oh, here it comes.
There you go. He wants to show you when you're down.
I'm excited to see it.
There you go.
Uh-oh.
I don't think I'll be surprised.
It's not so bad.
I think there's a real
I don't know. Yeah.
Is it just
a
yeah.
Yeah.
So So while he's working on it, I'll just say that the what we discovered in Act 54 was as we were putting together this racial disparities in the criminal and juvenile justice system advisory panel, we were also putting together an Attorney General and Human Rights Commission's task force. So this whole conversation about data is broader in a couple of different ways. One reason why it's broader is because it was always intended that we would be looking at the entire criminal justice system, not just law enforcement. So if you look at Act 54, Act 134 in 2012, Susie's original intent was that we were going after prosecutors. Well, we're not going after them, but we were looking to collect data across prosecutors and judges to include the correction system as well. That was her original intent. If you recall that really crappy report that came back from this crime research group on sentencing and incarceration, I call it the $20,000 report because it's infamously the only $20,000 we've ever spent on this kind of work. But that report was horrible. We asked for the Law Enforcement Advisory Board to provide us recommendations on reporting of incidents, and they came back with a report at the end of that year and said they didn't have time to do it. We never revisited. This is all as a result of Act 134. We also looked across into other areas of the justice system looking for data. But what happened sequentially in 2014 and 2016 through Act 147 and Act 193, respectively, every time we came back to addressing Title 20, 2366, increasingly we focused more and more on law enforcement and law enforcement alone. What our initial challenge was, what our initial goal was, really, if you really think about it, those who were there, was there was an attempt to just prove that there were disparities. That was the initial attempt. And I think we must always remember, we can never forget, because I think it would be harmful for us at this point, is we're past that now. We're no longer trying to prove that there are disparities, because with Act 54, what we discovered with the Attorney General's and the Human Rights Commission's task force was that there are racial disparities in housing, in education, in employment, and in health services access, to include economic development, as well as the criminal justice system. This is what that report indicated.
You might need to use the other adapter there.
So this is what that report indicated, and that's the exact reason why the following year we would pass Act 9, and we would ultimately end up hiring Susanna Davis to do the work. So sometimes we have to remind ourselves why we are where we are. I want to show you just briefly. This is the Crime Research Group's website. Now all we're talking about right now is we're just talking about race. We're talking about traffic data right now for law enforcement. Mind you, there are data across the remainder of the criminal justice system to include prosecutors and judges and corrections that we have not even touched yet. There's nothing mandating that data be collected. All we're talking about is one very, very small, minuscule piece of this race data collection component, and that's only in the criminal justice system. So we haven't began to talk about housing and education and employment and health services access and all of the data points, high impact, high discretion data points, which will need to be collected across those systems and where those data will reside. So this is that conversation. But let's just go, for the sake of this conversation, and just take a very quick look. And this is the reason why this is important, because I'm trying to explain the magnitude of, it's really difficult to manipulate this thing without. So this is just, first of all, illustrating the difficulty in finding the data. First, you have to find out that there's this site called the Crime Research Group. Then you find out where it was, and you go to data downloads. okay, what do we do from here, folks? So there's this race traffic data here. There's another click. Okay, so now what we have is we have 15, 16, 17, and 18. So you can see already how problematic this is, because there's we could immediately distinguish our inability for comparative analysis or even trend analysis at this point. But let's just get happy and go over in 2017. And this is what we get. And each one of these are spreadsheets, at least the ones that are in green. And this is how you get to your data. Let's just say hypothetically we wanted to go to Montpelier because I like Tony Fagos. So this is what we come up with, okay? You would be able to simply download an Excel spreadsheet. That's it. That's all you get. Are you getting my point?
Yeah.
That is the condition that we are in. You know, so we may not want to overly prescribe, but we want a certain amount of specificity when we talk about publicly available.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Yeah. Choose our battles, I think.
Yeah, so to date, what we're looking at now is the fact that, hold on for a sec, that this right here, that's Rajni. This right here, this dashboard that we put together as the Alliance, this is the only tool available in this state to provide any data comparative or trend analysis on those 79 agencies for those 5 years. Hard stop. That's the significance of the work that we're doing. But it also illustrates the work that must be done. Okay? It illustrates the fact that with a $6.2 billion budget, we've got to figure out how to make some wiggle room, because those data are that important, not just for law enforcement, but also for the rest of the justice system. Fagel, you were going to say something about data collection, and I want to use you as a segue. Yeah. If you want to talk about that bill,
should I talk about?
Yeah, let's get into that. You want to just go ahead, and I'll just be messing around.
I'll give you just a very quick summary of kind of what's under consideration right now. So House Judiciary heard testimony. Was that just last week? I believe so. So there's a bill that was introduced last year by a number of members of the committee that is looking for data collection that is disaggregated by race. From the state's attorneys, judiciary, and DOC.
This is 464?
284.
284.
Oh, 284.
And then would require annual reporting from those agencies about their findings to the legislature. So that's, in the simplest form, that is what the bill would require. And it's something that has...
What is internal analysis for each agency?
They have to provide the data and then report it back and provide what that data, like the raw data as well, but and provide a report.
Okay.
And so I think one of the things that's been really interesting over this last year is the Council of State Governments, as part of the Justice Reinvestment Project, has been working very closely with DOC specifically at analyzing their data, which has been a really, really intensive process, but it's also yielded some very interesting results that is helping us understand better how our system's working, especially when you're looking at the high rate of returns to prison for revocations, when you're also helped illuminate. So it's about 80% of all admissions to prison in the sentence population are revocations. So that's something that was new. That's something we probably should have known, but it's new because they were able to do that in-depth analysis and work with DOC. So I think that's a good indicator of some of the value that we get from this data.
That's awesome, because the technicalities that are returning majority people to prison.
So that's just a quick update on that bill. I know House Judiciary took very kind of quick initial testimony, heard from some of the stakeholders saying they would need more resources to accomplish some of this. But so that's one of those bills. I think parts of that might get rolled into the Justice Reinvestment bill is going to be introduced tomorrow morning by Senate Judiciary. I have not seen any drafts of what that might look like.
Me either.
No one has. I think other than Senator Sears at this point.
It's probably out there at this point.
I mean, yeah, I don't know. I don't know how it's going to get rolled out, but they're working on moving that bill very quickly. And we'll have it introduced tomorrow out of committee by the end of next week. So that gives you an idea. So that's, I just wanted to give folks a quick update on that bill. So it's House Judiciary is looking at it, and I think depending on what happens with the Justice Reinvestment Bill, it might be taken up again, especially in conjunction with my, what might come over from the Senate.
Who testified in the House when it was introduced?
Me. And then it was the sheriffs and state's attorneys to the judiciary and DOC. Yeah, and they all literally got up there together to testify.
What was their position?
They understood why people were requesting. And you can help supplement if I characterize this incorrectly at all, but they understood why people wanted that data, but they also said that it would require resources to do what was being asked of them in that bill.
Can you use the state attorney's office?
No, I represent Rowland City. That's fine. I serve on the House Judiciary Committee.
So we had some conversations with Maxine, as well as Barbara, as well as Coach and others, and it seems like there's certainly some interest in the House Judiciary, and I think what Maxine said, I think Maxine's out this week, Coach, right?
She's from Norwich University, selected in the president.
Right. So what she indicated was that they were indeed on hold, waiting for Justice Reinvestment to find out where they would come out on it. Right. I think that my concern, Coach, is that with Justice Reinvestment 2, is I'm not really getting strong indication that data is going to be really necessarily. I think that it's definitely on the radar. I don't know that it's central to any policy suggestions that I've heard over there on that side.
It is central in the recommendations they put forward. It was one of their four main recommendations.
Okay.
Is that we need better data collection. Their focus is more specifically on DOC, and they said that's because that's the data set that they were working with, and they, I think, understood a lot of the limitations that they were facing in terms of actually trying to get to what they wanted to get to. And when we talked to them, we pointed out that there are similar limitations across the system, but that they felt less able to speak to those because they were not working as closely with that data. So that it was one of their top line recommendations that we need to improve data capacity. They've asked specifically in their recommendations for more data capacity within DOC and to help support that work with reinvestment funding. So that was an area where we said we think that recommendation and brought that up in front of folks and are making that case. But so I'm not exactly sure, as is anyone, I think, at this point, what exactly that recommendation is going to be in statute. But I think it's also kind of being conversation ends up in the Appropriations Committee in some form or another as well.
Coach, has there been any conversation about some kind of, and Bill, maybe you can help as well, some kind of centralized data infrastructure capacity with, you know, to facilitate some kind of shared resource, maybe some kind of buyback structure where, just like all other IT, is kind of farmed out to the state. You know, here's this massive centralized backend database that aggregates, correlates, and provides that presentation level data across all agencies, depending on how they want it structured, as opposed to every agency just saying, "Oh, I need to secure independent appropriations."
I'm not aware of it. And the thing is, it goes back to what Bill said earlier. When he was doing his directed work, in judiciary, people really like their silos, and local control. I mean, people are still
local train wrecks.
People are still pissed off about Act 46. And when you think about that generalized statement, the interest in creating a unified, database, because I understand where we need to go with that. We dealt with the same thing with education and human services. Why aren't we for pre-K, having consistent data so that we could better perform our work, just like we need better consistent data to do the work around racial justice and social justice in general.
Sure. Yeah. The reason why I ask that question is because I can assure you, you know, whether it's Rick Gauthier or whether it's Mike Shirley, or whether it's John himself or Matt or whomever, the primary pushback we're going to get, and we already know it, is who's going to pay for it. It's about time, who's going to go in, because first it's a manual exercise, because you automate nothing without a manual exercise. So somebody's going to have to go in and figure out what are those high impact, high discretion decision points within those particular agencies. Who's going to go in and collect those data, and how's it going to be formatted and reported upon, and then how is that process ultimately going to be mapped back into an automated process to onto maybe a back-end database or something. So all of that stuff requires, you know, a lot of planning, a lot of model technologies, yeah, to full disclosure. What that means is that if the only way we're really going to be able to circumvent that, well, maybe not the only way, but one of the major ways that we could potentially circumvent that is let's find a common denominator. Let's find out where all of this stuff, what are we really doing this for? And I keep ending up on Susanna Davis's desk, okay? Because that's the reason why we started all of this work to begin with, is this is about the work that we're doing to mitigate systemic racism across all state government agencies, as Act 9 says.
But, you know, in getting to that point that Pat brought up in his discussion along the way, is let's get back to basics. Consistency. You know, regardless of whose desk it resides on, if there's a bunch of crap coming to the desk, we're not going to be able to disaggregate that data the way that, you know, Pat was talking about.
You know, expand on that a little bit. I'm not sure.
We've all built databases, okay, over the years. And one of the things that we know is that if you design the fields and you train the folks on what we want in those fields, when we get ready to pull out the queries, we can get just about anything we want.
Of course, yeah.
You know, so it goes back to what Pat was talking about, was the design. And so probably right now, just listening to the testimony that we've been getting, the state police and NICS are probably the most consistent database, you know, that we have. You know, it's national. Every officer that enters any data into that side of the system does it the exact same way.
Yeah. The state police data has been pretty clean.
Yeah. I think what we're talking about now is because we have to be able to separate the conversation.
That's why the state police data is better.
Right. So what we have to do is we have to be able to separate the conversation on infrastructure.
Yeah, well, that's
so there's an infrastructure conversation, but then there's a business process conversation. Okay, the infrastructure, as far as infrastructure is concerned, a database is a database is a database is a database. A network is a network is a network is a network. So there's that, you know, right. There's hardware, there's the cloud, there's so the, all of that stuff remains. When you start talking about standards, you know, as far as the applications are concerned, how data gets from an application to all the way to a back end database, you know, that really, when you start getting into those standards, you really start to talk about business processes. Like with the police, what we've decided is those business processes are Title 20, 2366. Did you stop them? Did you search them? So all of those, we define those for them at a very high level. Whereas with the state's attorney's office, at least what we're proposing now, and this is obviously open for debate, because obviously what we want to do is get a bunch of testimony and get this all fleshed out, hopefully. But there's questions like the number and percentage of cases that result in accepted pleas, the lesser charges identified by original charge pled by or individual, and the age, race, gender, and so forth, the number and percentage of cases in the state's attorneys, so on and so forth. So these are all those fields. And when you get to corrections, it's in here. When you get to when you get to housing, we'll have to define those. So these are all those are all business. What I'm talking about as far as data is concerned, I'm talking about the infrastructure, because that's where you're going to get the pushback on. I mean, as far as the this right here, we can define these as far as, you know, what are the high, and what I mean by high impact, high discretion is again, we're talking about, if we're talking about implicit bias, we're talking about systemic racism, right? What we discovered was, is with the police, that there were certain data points that we would be able to collect that if we, and we don't want all of them, because that's analysis paralysis. What we want is we just want some of them so we can first, initially it was to prove something was there, but now so we can begin to continue to look back at that data on a recurring basis, provided that it's consistent, to determine what? If we're making progress, right?
But Mark, I guess the point that I was trying to get at there is that we spend millions of dollars on that infrastructure. And in spending—
probably hundreds of millions.
You know, it's millions, okay, for Vermont. Okay, you know, we haven't done the 100 piece because I know, because you can tell by the crap that comes out of it. But the point being—
that's process, though. The crap that comes out of it.
No, well, but the thing is, if you buy crappy stuff on the front end, you know, what's going to come out is crap on the other end, too. So, you know, that's the point that bothers me a little bit.
Sure.
And it isn't— I understand what you're saying about, you know, too much data is just as bad as not having enough, and the quality, you know, that piece. I like the concept of looking at what is our goal and what are we attempting to achieve from, you know, that piece. And I guess in the ask, we're already funding, you know, those systems. And I think it's having, you know, people like, you know, Pat and, you know, Stephanie to, you know, to look at, you know, how can we best utilize that and take the resources that we have, you know, within the state, you know, like having people like you and Dr. Sequino, you know, saying, okay, this isn't, you know, super high tech. You know, I mean, it's a question of collective will, I guess.
Yeah, and I think Mark mentioned civilian oversight, but, you know, interested stakeholders who have some expertise.
Yeah.
We're willing to engage.
See, that's where the rubber hits the road. Because every time that we've asked, you know, one of the agencies, it doesn't matter, housing, you know, education or whatever, we end up with stupidness. You know,
See, here's one of the things, though, and I'll close with this, and I'll and maybe take maybe a couple final questions, is that for us to not do this, Here's what it's costing us. We're currently not doing this, okay? So here's what it's costing us, is because our strategic and our collective approach to addressing systemic racism is as follows. What we've decided to do, and I think our best example is public safety and specifically law enforcement. What we've decided to do is a series of things, and it makes sense, and it's also effective. First of all, when somebody knows that you are effectively collecting data, when they know that you're paying attention, their attitude changes, right? Their actions change. We just saw that depicted on the graph here earlier, okay? When people know that somebody's watching, just by virtue of the fact that they know that you're watching, it's psychological, but it's logical.
I have to make the comment that's not necessarily a good thing.
No.
It can go the wrong way, too.
It could go the wrong way, but before we talk about the wrong way, let me just make the point first, and I'll offer you an opportunity to chime in. So that's just, it's actually a side note, so it's really not the central theme of what I'm trying to articulate. What I'm really getting at is there is a policy initiative underway with our law enforcement. There is a massive effort underway to implement policy across all 79 agencies. We call it the Fair and Impartial Policing Policy, okay? It is the other part of Title 20, 2366, okay? So there is the race data collection part,
But within that same paragraph, there's something that talks about fear and crush police. Then there is this training component. Not only have we talked about the idea of academy training, but also one-time block training as well as in-service training. So there is a massive investment that's in play right now to every 79, all of the 79 agencies. Why? To augment this approach that we're doing to do what? To address systemic racism, okay? The data piece is just the measurement. But if you can't measure it, you can't manage it. And what you're doing with all of this money back here on these other two fronts, I have no idea, but it's not effective because we, over here on the outcome, not only can we not measure it in housing, education, employment, health services access, and other places, but we can't even measure it in law enforcement because nobody's collecting the data from the crime research group. Nobody can do a comparative analysis on it. Nobody can do a trend analysis on it, except us. You're going to say something?
Well, there's a few assumptions, but I experienced that once I've become aware of my subliminal biases that I might start overreaching. Mm-hmm. So I could imagine a future where the cop won't pull over the black suspect, even though he has the instinct to pull him over, and then let the might-be criminal go, mm-hmm. when in reality that would have been a hit.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think we're, sorry to interrupt you.
I
just think we're so far from that moment that I think we really have to fight to get to the equitable place. And I mean, I understand the pendulum swing, but we're so far from the moment where black people are not impacted by police officers.
So before everybody jumps on Jason, this is my buddy. I brought him.
I'm not jumping. I am not jumping on you. That was my first reaction to what you said. But I was going to say about analysis, I don't know if it's what you were talking about.
I love the perspective.
I was thinking that when agencies, though, know that they're going to be held accountable, it's less likely that it swings the other way. It's more likely that they are checking themselves a little bit more than they would be in terms of analysis. I think the lack of accountability has been a massive issue across the country, mm-hmm. and probably world, on bias.
Thanks, Brenda. Brian?
Yeah, speaking to that piece, I'll come up here so people don't have to get whiplash looking.
I was twisting.
Because I know it hurts my neck to do that. So when I was on the Burlington School Board, we really kind of laid down the law around issues of disparities because we were seeing such disparity in the discipline of youth. And then what happened was, I was on the Diversity and Equity Committee, parents started coming to the committee representing different new American communities, saying to us, the teachers are letting our kids get away with too much. And we were like, what do you mean? And so we heard what you were talking about, which is there were some teachers who were calling children monkeys, like, that bad, you know what I mean?
Yes.
Well, on one hand, but on the other hand, there were teachers letting like children of color like get away with so much that it was actually undermining the parents' efforts at home to discipline them.
Wow.
And so it really made the point you said, which is sometimes when you challenge people about something, they overcompensate.
Mm-hmm.
And so really, what came out of that was a discussion about what, like, how should we raise children as a community, and how do we support families, and how do we, and so ultimately, I don't think it was a bad thing,
mm-hmm.
to call people's attention to it. You just have to be there to support those workers when, you know what I mean? Like, and so if we're gonna do this, we need to pair this with training of government workers like police and court workers and teachers and everyone else, so that, you know, just support an ongoing training. And like some of the teachers had said to us, when you bring us in and you do one diversity training to check a box,
yeah.
and that's it,
yeah.
Yeah.
then there's no guidance on how to interpret it. And what I always thought would be good is if we had some way to work with the union or some way to work with the teachers, mm-hmm. to like have like supervision like social workers do, where they get to meet in small groups regularly and like process things like,
mm-hmm.
oh, I did this with this kid, like what would you have done? So I'm just putting it out there. Like,
see, one of the things that I'll share with you, and this works, I think, in all areas of, you know, let's say public, you know, the domains. And when you mention like social work, best practices are best practices. So be it education, police work, what have you. If something's working really well, you know, in an agency within that spectrum, why aren't we replicating that? You know, and that's what, you know, kind of, you know, gets to me, because, you know, we know it's working. If you've got an engine that runs really well, why would you make an engine over here not run well? You know, I mean, it's a very simple metaphor, but that's like the brush your teeth metaphor.
Uh-oh.
You know?
Right. Yes.
Nice example. Okay.
You know, we don't go around telling people we just brush our teeth once a year.
Mm-hmm. No, that's not.
You know? No, we tell them you need to floss, and you need to oil pull, and you need to scrape your tongue, and then you need to...
we pushed up against it at 7:30, and I committed to you that I was going to try to get you out of here at 7:15, but it is 7:30.
But I think that's that rest of the story, you know, and that's what you were talking about in reference to, is as we start to disaggregate, you know, what we have versus what we want, we start to see that occur.
Absolutely, absolutely. Patrick.
Thanks, Mark.
Pat, you got anything else?
Good. Thanks, everybody.
I just want to say that this conversation is incredibly important. It's why we chose it for this legislative series. So thanks for all who come out. You know, thanks to the legislators. I mean, definitely for coming out and showing up. And we will be back. The next legislative series, Coach, is on the 13th of February.
That is the next one. Well, we can celebrate Valentine's Day with you.
That'll be reparations. So,
wow, that's appropriate.
Reparations in Vermont. Reparations in Vermont, is that a thing? So 13th of February, we'll be in this room. Thank you all.